Hello and welcome to Byju's IAS. Let's take up the analysis of today's The Hindu newspaper. For the first time, India has publicly acknowledged that China has indeed made significant troop deployments across the border. For more than 1 month, India and China have been locked in a border standoff across multiple locations along the line of actual control, including at the Panong So Lake, the Galwan River Valley, the Hot Springs area in Ladakh, and at the Nakula sector in Sikkim. And for the first time, India's defense minister has publicly acknowledged that China has indeed made significant troop deployments at these standoff points. In response to this troop buildup of China, it is being reported that even India has mobilized a large contingent of troops and equipment to the forward areas. Even as both the countries continue to mobilize their troops, efforts are being made to resolve the border standoff diplomatically through peaceful negotiations. As per established de-escalation mechanisms and protocols, talks have been held at the level of local military commanders. But these talks at the local level have failed to yield any results, and hence, negotiations are going on between senior military commanders of both the sides, and a very important dialogue is slated to be held on the 6th of June between India and China. Along with this, the political leadership of both the countries have activated their diplomatic back channels in order to work out a peaceful resolution to the standoff. Whenever India and China are headed towards such a border confrontation, the most commonly asked question is whether both the countries are headed towards a conflict. Especially the media in both the countries, they try to whip up patriotic and nationalistic sentiments by claiming that a war between India and China is imminent. But however, both the governments are responsible and mature enough to realize that neither side would be able to afford the cost of a conflict between two of the largest Asian powers. Any conflict between India and China is going to cost both the countries very heavily, both in terms of money and as well as in terms of men. Hence, in order to prevent such a conflict, and in order to prevent a border standoff from escalating into a conflict, sufficient conflict resolution mechanisms have been put in place through various de-escalation agreements and protocols that have been established between the two sides. There are 5 such de-escalation agreements in particular. This includes the Agreement on Maintenance of Peace and Tranquility along the Line of Actual Control, signed in 1993. The Agreement on Confidence Building Measures in the Military Field along the LAC, which was signed in 1996. Then in 2005, an agreement was signed which provided for the protocol for implementing these confidence building measures between the two militaries. Then in 2012, another agreement was signed which provided for a working mechanism for promoting consultation and coordination between the two countries on border affairs. Then more importantly, the Border Defense Cooperation Agreement, which was signed recently in 2013, has inbuilt de-escalation mechanisms in order to prevent a border standoff from escalating into a conflict. That's the reason why it is said that the chances of a full-blown war between India and China is highly unlikely, because there are sufficient conflict resolution mechanisms that have been put in place. Next, on page number 11, we have a related article which provides a greater insight into the conflict resolution mechanism that has been established between India and China by referring to the Daepsang incident of 2013. But before we look at this article, first we need to understand where Daepsang is located. See, this is where Daepsang is located. It is located in Ladakh along the line of actual control, and it is located to the south-southeast of Daulat Beg Oldi. This map also shows a number of other locations which can be important for prelims and mains. You can see Kargil over here. You can also see the line of control that defines the ceasefire line between India and Pakistan. You can see Pakistan-occupied Kashmir that is under the illegal occupation of Pakistan. This is the Shaksgam Valley which Pakistan illegally ceded to China after the 1962 war. Then you can also see the Karakoram Range and the Karakoram Pass that are located to the north of Siachen Glacier. The Siachen Glacier in particular is a strategic location for India, where India occupies a vantage position. Then you can see point NJ9842, which is the northernmost point of the line of control between India and Pakistan. Then with regard to China, we can see the line of actual control, which represents the current border between India and China. You can see the Aksai Chin region, which is under the illegal occupation of China, but the entire region is claimed by India. Then you can also see the major flashpoints between India and China, such as Daulat Beg Oldi, Depsang, Panang So, Demchok, etc. Currently, according to reports, thousands of Chinese troops have occupied few kilometers of Indian territory at the Galwan River Valley, at Depsang and the Panang So Lake, and this threatens to cut off the access of Indian troops to areas in Aksai Chin and other strategic areas including the Karakoram Pass. India has claimed that it was China which violated the sanctity of the line of actual control, and it was Chinese troops which carried out the incursion, and they are the ones who are currently occupying Indian territory. And of course, China has claimed that it was Indian troops who violated the line of actual control, and it goes on to show that most of the disputes between India and China occur because of differing perceptions with regard to the demarcation of the line of actual control. But strategic experts also believe that China has deliberately carried out these incursions this time round as a response to India's increased military and logistical capabilities along the LAC over the last 10 years. So this article on page number 11 says that the current tensions around the Depsang area is a reminder of the Depsang incident which took place in 2013. See, the Depsang region has seen many such conflicts and standoffs between India and China in the past. This is because the Depsang region is a plain area as compared to the hilly terrain that is present around it. Since the Depsang region is a plain area along the LAC, it creates an opening between India and China, and it enables the easier movement of light armored vehicles, which can help in easier mobilization of troops and equipment. During the current standoff, it has been reported that China has capitalized on the Depsang plain area, and it has deployed a large number of troops, it has pitched tents, and has even deployed heavier equipment by using light armored vehicles. These developments have got India extremely worried because it reminds India of the 1962 conflict. During the 1962 war, through similar aggressive strategies, China had occupied the Depsang area before it was returned back to India after the ceasefire. But the article suggests a conflict resolution strategy for the government of India to overcome the current crisis by referring to the statements of India's former National Security Advisor, Mr. Shiv Shankar Menon, who also served as the special representative for India-China boundary talks from 2010 to 2014. See, under the special representative mechanism, it is India's National Security Advisor who acts as the special representative. By virtue of this position, Shiv Shankar Menon had personally dealt with the Depsang incident, and in his popular book Choices, he has outlined how the government of India dealt with the 2013 incursion. Shiv Shankar Menon says that India had adopted a two-pronged strategy in order to resolve the conflict through peaceful negotiations. As a part of this strategy, India had applied a combination of diplomatic and political pressure in order to push back China from the areas that it had occupied around Depsang. During this tense period, Indian diplomats such as Shiv Shankar Menon, the then National Security Advisor, and India's current Foreign Minister S. Jaishankar, who was then India's ambassador to China, they made it clear to the Chinese side that Chinese troops need to move back from the standoff point, and they also verified the end point to which the Chinese troops had to withdraw in order to avoid any repeat incursions. Along with such diplomatic pressure, political pressure was exerted by the government of India by threatening to call off the upcoming visit of the Chinese Premier to India. So a combination of diplomatic and political pressure, along with strict adherence to established agreements and protocols, helped India and China to resolve the standoff in 2013. And hence, Shiv Shankar Menon says that there are three essential steps to any successful conflict resolution. One, both the governments need to tame down their rhetoric against each other, and they need to stay away from making any controversial public statements against each other. In this regard, Shiv Shankar Menon appreciates the Modi government for not making any controversial statements in the public during the current standoff. Even China, for the time being, has tried to keep down its public rhetoric, and this creates the right platform for both the governments to negotiate away from the unnecessary attention of the media and the public. Shiv Shankar Menon says that it is very essential to show strength to the adversary in order to make them realize that we do have the capabilities to defend ourselves and deter an attack, and such display of strength has a deterrence value. Because once the defensive capabilities are made known to the adversary, it prevents the adversary from escalating the conflict further, and it pushes them towards the negotiating table. So since the display of strength has a deterrence value, it possibly explains the troop buildup from both the sides. So it means that a troop buildup does not essentially mean a preparation towards war. Instead, it is basically a diplomatic strategy being adopted by both the sides in order to project strength and establish deterrence in order to prevent the breakout of a conflict. Next, the third step is that a well-designed diplomatic negotiation will always provide a way out for the adversary. During diplomatic negotiations, if an adversary feels that he has been pushed into a corner and isolated, that is when he is more likely to escalate the crisis, which could significantly increase the chances of a conflict. So Shivshankar Menon says that diplomatic negotiations should always work towards providing an honorable exit to both the players so that it appeals to their respective domestic audiences, which reduces their need to escalate the conflict further. Then, after having learnt its lessons during the 1962 war and during the 2013 incursion, India has scaled up its deployment of troops and equipment, especially in and around the Depsang region. Post 2014, India has deployed sufficient number of T-72 tanks, and more number of troops are deployed constantly on rotational basis in order to acclimatize them to high altitude warfare in the Himalayan region. Now let's take up the next article. Cyclone Nisarga, which was brewing in the Arabian Sea, has graduated from a deep depression into a severe cyclonic storm, and it is headed towards Maharashtra and Gujarat. Cyclone Nisarga is expected to make landfall near Alibaug with wind speeds up to 120 km per hour. And Mumbai, which happens to be in the path of the cyclone, is gearing up to deal with the twin challenge of the COVID-19 pandemic and the cyclone. Last week, if it was Kolkata, which had to deal with the twin challenge of the COVID-19 pandemic and a super cyclone, now it is Mumbai, which is dealing with a similar challenge. So this brings up the question as to what are the differences between cyclones that form in the Arabian Sea and cyclones that form in the Bay of Bengal. In any given year, we read about more cyclones forming in the Bay of Bengal. We also read that cyclones that form in the Bay of Bengal are more intense and destructive as compared to the cyclones that form in the Arabian Sea. So to understand this in detail, let us have a more elaborate discussion on what makes the Bay of Bengal deadly as far as cyclones are concerned, and why is the Bay of Bengal considered as the hotspot for cyclones in the world. See, data shows that 8 out of 10 deadliest tropical cyclones in the world have originated in the Bay of Bengal. Out of the 36 most deadly tropical cyclones that have ever been recorded, 26 of them were formed in the Bay of Bengal. So this makes the Bay of Bengal, which is the largest bay in the world, a hotbed for tropical cyclones. See, it is not that the Arabian Sea does not witness any cyclonic activity. In fact, both Bay of Bengal and Arabian Sea, they both experience cyclonic events. But the frequency and intensity with which cyclones form in the Bay of Bengal is many times higher than what happens in the Arabian Sea. When you compare the two water bodies, you will find that Bay of Bengal sees approximately 5 times more cyclones as compared to the Arabian Sea. And even these cyclones that form in the Bay of Bengal, they are many times stronger and deadlier as compared to the cyclones that form in the Arabian Sea. Upon this, 58% of the cyclones that form in the Bay of Bengal, they make landfall on the Indian coast and they cause extensive damage along the coastline. Whereas in comparison, only 25% of the cyclones that form in the Arabian Sea make landfall on the Indian coast, and they are not known to be as destructive as the cyclones that form in the Bay of Bengal. See, in order to understand what makes Bay of Bengal a hotbed for cyclonic activity, we need to go back to basic geography and understand the concept of tropical cyclones. See, cyclones are essentially intense water rotating systems. In a cyclonic system, you basically have very strong winds that are rotating around low pressure areas. And these systems that stretch over hundreds of kilometers, they require certain ideal conditions to sustain themselves. The tropical cyclones that form in the North Indian Ocean, which includes the Bay of Bengal and the Arabian Sea, they would have established a spiral system and they would be rotating in an anti-clockwise direction as a result of the impact of the Coriolis force in the Northern Hemisphere. So for these cyclonic systems to sustain, a few ideal weather conditions are needed, such as a constant supply of moisture. And a constant supply of moisture can exist only when the rate of evaporation is very high. And for this to occur in the open seas, you need the sea to have a very high surface temperature. Along with this, if there are vertical changes in wind speed inside the spiral, and if relative humidity inside the spiral is very high, these conditions can help the cyclone to form and intensify further. And unfortunately for the Bay of Bengal, all these ideal conditions exist. Bay of Bengal is a warm sea. The sea surface temperature is very high, and also relative humidity levels are higher than average. Bay of Bengal receives higher rainfall than the Arabian Sea, and this keeps relative humidity higher. Along with this, wind currents in the Bay of Bengal are pretty slow, and as a result, the sea surface temperature in the Bay of Bengal is as high as 28 degrees Celsius throughout the year. The presence of warm air currents in the region further increases the surface temperature, and hence the high rate of evaporation provides a constant supply of moisture, which aids the formation and intensification of cyclones in the Bay of Bengal. Plus, the higher rainfall that the Bay of Bengal receives and the constant inflow of fresh water from east flowing rivers of the Indian subcontinent, such as the Ganga, Brahmaputra, the Mahanadi, Godavari, Krishna and the Kaveri, brings in a constant supply of warm water, and this makes it impossible for the warm water to mix with the cooler water below. So these conditions are ideal for the formation of a low pressure area, which can easily turn into a depression and further graduate into a high intensity cyclone. On the other hand, in the Arabian Sea, you will find that the wind currents are stronger. This will help in dissipating the heat and reducing the sea surface temperature. And also, the west flowing rivers of the Indian subcontinent bring in a very small supply of fresh water, and hence warm water gets to mix with the cool water below, and this further reduces the sea surface temperature. Then another reason for Bay of Bengal for witnessing more cyclones than the Arabian Sea is because Bay of Bengal imports the cyclonic systems from the Pacific Ocean as well. See, cyclonic systems that form over water bodies, they can travel over large distances unless and until they encounter a large landmass. Once a cyclone encounters a large landmass, it cuts off the moisture supply, and hence it will dissipate the cyclone. But between the Pacific Ocean and the Bay of Bengal, there is no such large landmass, and we only have small islands in Southeast Asia and the narrow stretch of Thailand. And hence, the cyclonic systems that form in the Pacific, they can easily cross over Southeast Asia, and they also enter the Bay of Bengal. So this also contributes to the occurrence of more cyclones in the Bay of Bengal as compared to the Arabian Sea. These imported cyclones from the Pacific Ocean, they do not enter the Arabian Sea because they encounter the Indian landmass, and they are blocked by the Western Ghats from reaching the Arabian Sea. Then there is another reason which makes the cyclones in the Bay of Bengal more destructive than the ones in the Arabian Sea. And according to experts, this has to do with the triangular shape or funnel shape of the Bay of Bengal. Experts believe that the funnel shape and the closed shape of Bay of Bengal leads to the further intensification of the cyclone, resulting in massive storm surges. In fact, in a number of cases, it has been noticed that it is not the high-speed winds or torrential rains that kill more people, but it is actually the storm surges which kills more people and causes more destruction. And also, if you look at the Bay of Bengal towards the Indian shore, it is very shallow, and this further enables a storm surge. So as a result, the low-lying areas along Andhra Pradesh, Odisha, West Bengal, etc., they get inundated, and these storm surges make the cyclones of Bay of Bengal more destructive as compared to the ones in Arabian Sea. So these are the different reasons which make Bay of Bengal the hotbed of cyclonic activity, and it also explains why more number of cyclones form in the Bay of Bengal as compared to the Arabian Sea, and why they are more destructive as compared to the ones that form in the Arabian Sea. But of late, climate change and global warming is adding a new dimension to this traditional understanding of cyclone formation in the North Indian Ocean. In recent years, it has been observed that cyclonic activity in the Arabian Sea has also increased, and this was very evident in 2019. Because last year, Arabian Sea witnessed a very unusual number of cyclones, and around 5 major cyclones were formed in this water body. Climatologists and meteorologists agree that climate change and global warming has contributed to the intensification of cyclone formation in both the Bay of Bengal and as well as in the Arabian Sea. Now let's take up the next article. US President Donald Trump has invited Prime Minister Modi to take part in the upcoming G7 summit, which is to be hosted by the United States. See, the G7 is an intergovernmental economic organization consisting of the 7 largest IMF advanced economies. All the seven countries are Western democracies, including the United States, United Kingdom, France, Germany, Canada, Italy, and Japan. This organization was established in 1975, following the oil crisis which was seen in the 1970s. The European Union also takes part in the G7 summit as a regular invitee. And in 1998, the G7 was expanded to the G8 by including Russia as well. But in 2014, Russia was suspended from the grouping because of its annexation of Crimea, which led to the increase in geopolitical tensions between Western countries and Russia. So this reverted the G8 back to the G7. But of late, internal conflicts have been increasing within the G7. And US President Donald Trump has even gone to the extent of labeling the G7 as an outdated organization. Over the last couple of years, there have been conflicts between the United States and United Kingdom and Canada, France and Germany, especially over trade-related issues. And in this backdrop, President Trump has made a very interesting proposal. He has proposed to expand the G7 into either the G10 or the G11. He has proposed the inclusion of like-minded strong economies such as India, Australia and South Korea. And interestingly, he has also proposed the re-inclusion of Russia back into the grouping. See, over the years, due to India's increasing role in global economic affairs, it has been invited to take part in the G7 summit as an invitee. For example, in last year's G7 summit, Prime Minister Modi was invited to take part in the summit which was hosted by France. But India and even other countries, such as Australia and South Korea, they are not full-time members of the G7. And the proposal of Donald Trump to expand the G7 into the G10 or G11 by including India, Russia, Australia and South Korea represents one of the biggest geopolitical developments in the recent past, because such a grouping would clearly exclude China. So in the coming days, it would be interesting to watch whether these four countries would be willing to join such a grouping and whether the other existing members of G7 would be willing to accept the new members. It would also be interesting to watch how the geopolitical conflict between the US and China is going to increase if the proposal is taken forward. Because clearly, the intention of Donald Trump is to further isolate China. And if such a grouping is indeed formed, then China is definitely going to react, because it would feel that it is being pushed into a corner by the other countries. Now let's take up an editorial from page number 6, which evaluates the functioning of the India Meteorological Department, or IMD. See, the IMD is a key weather forecasting agency of the Government of India, which is under the Ministry of Earth Sciences. It is involved in forecasting a variety of weather phenomena, such as the arrival of monsoons. It also predicts the spread and distribution of the monsoons, and it is also involved in forecasting cyclones and drought conditions. Amongst all the early warning and forecasting services that the IMD provides, the most important service has to be its forecast of the arrival date of the monsoon and the spread and distribution of the monsoon for the particular year. This has to be the most important forecasting service of the IMD, because this forecast has a direct impact on the Indian economy. But IMD's forecast related to this year's monsoon has created quite a lot of confusion. In its early forecast in the month of April, the IMD had predicted the monsoon to arrive in Kerala on the 1st of June. Then later in May, it revised the date to the 5th of June, because it expected the western disturbances in the northwest of India and Cyclone Umphan to have an impact on the arrival of monsoons in India. See, western disturbances are basically the westerly wind currents which flow from the Mediterranean region to the northwest of India, and they pick up moisture over the Mediterranean Sea, bringing rainfall to the northwestern parts of India. The IMD had predicted that western disturbances and supercyclone Umphan would have an impact on the arrival date of monsoons in India. But these forecasts of the IMD were countered by private and international meteorological and weather forecasting agencies. Private forecasters such as SkyMet had predicted the monsoons to arrive in India on the 28th of May. Then recently, a European forecasting agency had predicted Cyclone Nisarga to have an impact on the arrival of monsoons. And this European agency had predicted the monsoons to arrive as late as the 8th of June. But the IMD countered these forecasts of private and international weather forecasting agencies and insisted that the monsoon would arrive in India in the first week of June. And surprisingly, the IMD has announced that the monsoon has arrived over Kerala on the 1st of June itself, as per textbook definition. See, this entire confusion between IMD's forecasts and the forecasts provided by private and international weather forecasting agencies is mainly because of the criteria that the IMD has laid out to determine the arrival of monsoons in India. As per the IMD, there are a set of conditions that need to be fulfilled to declare that the monsoons have arrived in India. As per this criteria, 8 out of the 14 designated meteorological stations of the IMD in Kerala and as well as in Karnataka, they must register a rainfall of 2.5 mm for 2 consecutive days. Then along with this, there must be a 30 to 40 km per hour westerly wind current that reaches India from the equator at a certain height, and the IMD also looks out for a certain value of radiation. So according to the IMD, just the arrival of heavy rains over Kerala alone does not determine the onset of monsoons, and it declares that the monsoon has arrived only if these three criteria are met. Whereas private and international forecasters, they do not go by this criteria, and this is what creates the conflict and the confusion between the two. But irrespective of this, one thing is very clear. The IMD is facing increased competition from private and international forecasting agencies. But as far as officially declaring the onset of monsoons and determining the spread and distribution of monsoons, the IMD still enjoys a monopoly, and considering the impact of its forecasts on the Indian economy, the editorial is calling upon the IMD to transform itself in order to compete with these private and international forecasting agencies. See, weather forecasts and early warning services are of great economic importance because weather-related forecasting has a direct impact on various sectors of the economy, such as agriculture, power distribution, crop insurance, etc. So various sectors of the economy, they rely upon accurate forecasts in order to plan ahead. But if these forecasts turn out to be inaccurate, then it can have economic consequences. For example, for 2020, the IMD has predicted a normal monsoon season for the northwest of India, central parts of India, and the southern peninsula. Whereas it expects the monsoons to be affected in the northeast of India. So based on this forecast, agricultural activities will be taken up across the country. And if the forecasts turn out to be inaccurate, it is going to have an impact on agricultural productivity. See, last year, the IMD had failed to predict that 2019 would be the wettest year in 2 decades. Heavy rains and floods across the country had caused extensive damage to agriculture and industrial activities. And this is how inaccurate forecasting can have an economic impact. But of course, the editorial understands the complexity involved in forecasting weather. Because weather forecasting is a technology and capital intensive business. Weather forecasting agencies would have to spend a lot of money in deploying sensors, in setting up stations, that too in remote and inaccessible parts of the country. They would also need access to satellite-based services. They would have to develop statistical models and weather forecasting models. And they also make use of supercomputers to run these weather forecasting models based on the data that they receive from these sensors and stations. And despite such extensive usage of technology, there is still going to be an error margin considering the complexity involved in forecasting. Then upon this, we need to add the complexity that is brought in by climate change and global warming. The unpredictability in weather and climatic conditions brought in by climate change and global warming has to be accounted for. So all these factors makes the task of the IMD very difficult and challenging. But despite this, the IMD has been quite efficient in providing early warning services, especially with regard to cyclones. The IMD is single-handedly responsible for saving thousands of lives every year by providing early warning with regard to cyclones along both the west coast and the east coast of India. This success of IMD with regard to early warning services can be attributed to its adoption of modern technology and to the development of an efficient public interface by engaging with the media, social media platforms, and as well as with other government agencies, especially the disaster management agencies. But when it comes to forecasting services, such as forecasting monsoons, the IMD is still found to be lacking. And this is where the editorial suggests a couple of steps in order to improve IMD's efficiency with regard to forecasting monsoons. The editorial says that the IMD first needs to work on its communication strategy. It needs to come up with a more efficient communication strategy to engage with the wider population, and it should seek to avoid such confusion. And second, Since weather forecasting is risky business, instead of providing for a forecast for the entire country, it is better for the IMD to come out with localized weather forecasts for each state and for each district. The IMD could also get more specific by providing for sub-zonal forecasts, which would automatically improve the efficiency and effectiveness of these forecasts, because such data would be more relevant for the local authorities, and it would help in efficient planning and efficient resource utilization at the ground level. Yes, the national level forecasts are also very important, especially for the central government and the central agencies, but localized weather forecasts would be even more important for the local authorities. Now let's take up an article from page number 15. The Government of India has announced 3 incentive-based schemes in order to promote manufacturing of electronics in the country. These 3 schemes include Production-Linked Incentive, Component Manufacturing Scheme, and Modified Electronics Manufacturing Cluster. These 3 schemes provides incentives of around 48,000 crore rupees to the electronics industry in order to establish India as a manufacturing hub for electronics and semiconductors. Amongst these 3 schemes, the Production-Linked Incentive Scheme plans to make India as a world leader with regard to manufacturing of mobile phones. Under this scheme, the government plans to provide incentives to around 10 mobile manufacturing companies, which would include 5 global companies and 5 domestic companies. India, which has already emerged as the second largest mobile manufacturer of the world, hopes that this scheme would help it to overtake China. The other 2 schemes, that is Component Manufacturing Scheme and Modified Electronics Manufacturing Clusters, they have been designed to promote manufacturing of electronics in India and create employment for around 10 lakh people over the next 5 years. Now let's take up the practice questions for today. What best describes the traditional occupation of the Changpa community? The correct answer is option B. They are nomadic high-altitude pastoralists rearing the prized Pashmina goat in Ladakh for Kashmir wool. This question has been asked because according to this article on page number 1, the repeated incursions by the Chinese PLA in Ladakh has affected the nomadic Changpa community from accessing the feeding grounds and grazing pastures which are used to raise the prized Pashmina goat, which produces the world-famous Kashmir wool, which is rated as one of the most expensive natural fabrics in the world. Now let's take up the next practice question. Which of the following statements are correct? The SARS coronavirus 2 is not known to have undergone any mutation. The same strain that was reported in Wuhan is said to be affecting every other country in the world, including India. Both the statements are incorrect, so option D is the right answer. See, this question was asked because according to this article on page number 9, scientists of CSIR have identified the second most common coronavirus type in India. This makes it very clear that the SARS coronavirus 2 has undergone a lot of mutation over the last few months. See, the strain that was first reported in Wuhan has been named as the type O. But later, this variant of SARS coronavirus 2 underwent a lot of mutation, and a variant known as A2A has emerged as the most dominant strain in the world. This strain of SARS coronavirus 2 underwent mutation in order to become more efficient in infiltrating our lungs. And based on the Indian samples studied by the CSIR, scientists have concluded that the most dominant strain in India happens to be the A2A strain. Amongst the samples that were studied, around 62% of them were reported to be affected by the A2A strain. And the study has also identified the second most common coronavirus type in India, that is the A3I, which reportedly accounts for nearly 41% of the samples that were analyzed. Now let's take up the next practice question. Which of the following statements are correct? The Kohala hydropower project, frequently seen in news, is coming up in Pakistan. India is involved in the project as a part of its developmental assistance to Afghanistan. Both the statements are incorrect. Option D is the right answer. This question has been asked because according to this article on page number 14, the Kohala hydropower project, which is coming up in Pakistan-occupied Kashmir, is being funded by China. In fact, the Kohala hydropower project is a part of the China-Pakistan economic corridor, which has been objected to by India. India has opposed the CPEC corridor and as well as all the other projects that are coming up as a part of the corridor, because India treats the entire POK region and the Gilgit-Baltistan region to be under the illegal occupation of Pakistan, and India claims complete territorial sovereignty over this region. Now let's take up the next practice question. The Murchison Widefield Array Radio Astronomy Observatory is located in Western Australia. Option A is the right answer. This question has been asked because according to this article on page number 16, Indian scientists from the Pune-based National Center for Radio Astrophysics have made use of data from the Murchison Widefield Array Radio Telescope to help find an answer that could possibly explain the sun's coronal heating puzzle. See, the sun's coronal heating puzzle is one of the greatest challenges and mysteries in the field of astrophysics. This is related to the difference in temperature on the sun's surface and in the sun's atmosphere, that is the sun's corona. While the sun's surface registers a temperature of just around 6000 degrees Celsius, the corona registers a temperature of around a few million degrees Celsius. So this huge difference in temperature is quite puzzling because the temperature is actually increasing as you move away from the heat source. While the nuclear reactions that produce the sun's energy is taking place inside the surface of the sun, its atmosphere, that is the corona, registers a temperature of a few million degrees Celsius. So since many decades, the field of astrophysics has tried to provide an explanation for this phenomena, and till date, it remains an unsolved mystery and it is referred to as the sun's coronal heating puzzle. Now let's take up a practice question from the 2015 prelims paper. Consider the following statements. The winds which blow between 30 degrees north and 60 degrees south latitudes throughout the year are known as westerlies. The moist air masses that cause winter rains in northwestern region of India are part of westerlies. Amongst the given statements, the first statement is incorrect. So the correct answer is option B, 2 only. See, the first statement is incorrect because westerlies can be found between the 30 to 60 degree north latitude and as well as between the 30 to 60 degree south latitudes. So this clearly makes the first statement incorrect. So option B is the right answer. Finally, let's take up a couple of mains practice questions. The first question, examine why the Bay of Bengal is known to be a hotbed for cyclones as compared to the Arabian Sea. But of late, cyclones have increased in the Arabian Sea as well. Evaluate the reasons behind this recent phenomena. The second question, the India Meteorological Department has been time and again criticized for its inefficiency in forecasting monsoons. Discuss. Kindly write an answer to these questions and post your answers in the comment section below. So this concludes our discussion for the day. Thanks for watching.